So, welcome everybody. My name is Jens Dittrich and this is Database Systems Core Lecture, this time about indexing. Where are we in our agenda? So, we are basically here. So last time we talked a bit about data layouts. This week and next week we will be talking about indexing. So I will be covering stuff like why not use a binary search tree anyway, the interplay with storage. We will talk about B-trees, not so much about hash tables. So I assume that you heard about hash tables in some undergrad lecture, but we won't be covering that anyway, if at all. You can call it as a library function, but you should have the idea about what a hash table does in principle, but I won't be covering that. We will talk a little bit about physical data independence in that regard. You might have heard about that term already in your undergrad lecture. And if time allows, next week I will also talk a bit more about ongoing fancy ideas in the space of indexing. If you have any questions in the following, I will be looking at Discord. We are not using Prague yet for the moment due to some bugs, so Discord text channel. So in the lecture break, I will also be available on the audio rooms and also after the lecture briefly. With that, let's start. So what's the motivation for all of that? Well, you see that in the real world already. Street signs, yeah? Assume you are in the Alps and you want to go somewhere to a specific place and assume you want to go to whatever, Faulhorn, interesting name for a place, but those are places in Switzerland. And well, one of your options, you can explore the entire Alps to eventually find out that you hit a place called Faulhorn, or you can follow street signs to shortcut your search. Yeah? That's what you will do. Yeah? Other than looking at a map, you follow the signs, and there may be another sign coming up. But basically, this reduces your space, your search space dramatically. Yeah? So rather than going to the right and also searching on the right, you know, okay, wherever that is exactly, that place I'm going to, it's somewhere on the left. I follow that path and there might be other street signs. And by that, you will be reducing your search space. And there are many variants of that. Maybe some of you might have seen that. So before the world, before the internet became popular in the 80s, like, prior to the 90s, I would say, there were catalogs made of paper, yeah? In particular in libraries. If you were looking for a specific book, you wouldn't type it into Google, but you just went to your local library and there were huge cabinets. There was an index with specific topics. And if you were looking for something like the history of tea, whatever tea means, history of Trump, I don't know, then yeah, you could look up draw and try to find an appropriate card that would guide you to a specific book. Yeah? That's another example for an index. And basically, that's the type of index you will be using when you type anything into Google. Yeah? That's basically what happens. Yeah? That's called an inverted index. Here's another example for a street sign. Basically, you do that on a daily basis. That's the street sign is just a synonym for index in the end. Yeah? And yeah, what does that mean in the world of databases? Well, in the world of databases, there are multiple indexes, but at the end of the day, if I had to pick one index that's really important and helps you find data quickly, that's the so-called B-tree. It's a very old index structure. It was invented in the early 70s already, and we'll look at that in the following. Before we go into how a B-tree actually looks like, some major properties, why that is important. So one is, it really works well with the storage hierarchy, which is not true for binary search trees. B-trees can be adjusted for any layer of storage hierarchy. And what that means, we will see in a moment. So that's very important. Then there's a good trade-off of random and sequential access. I told you about that in the lecture on hardware. So if an index supports this very well, then we win something. And that's not true for other index structures, for many other index structures. There are other index structures that also work well, but in particular, B-trees work super well. And this holds on storage layers like hard disk, SSD, but also on other storage layers like main memory. the B-tree can be adapted to work particularly well in that space. We will get to that. Then this is the third point is this universal applicability. So once you understand the B-tree and once you have another indexing problem, you will in most cases be able to map your new indexing problem to a B-tree. So whenever there's an indexing problem, it's rarely the case that you have to reinvent a completely new index structure. Yeah, you can very often map it to an existing B-tree, which makes a B-tree extremely interesting. Yeah? Because either the original straightforward textbook B-tree would solve the problem or any variant of that. There are zillions of variants of B-trees. And yeah, most of the time, they will do the job. So before we go into how a B-tree really looks like, I will give you some intuition and introduce some terminology. Just in case you miss that, I wrote it down on the slide again. Do not do it like this in practice. So this intuition slides is not how you would do it, obviously. But you will see why. So in the following, we will basically what we're trying to do is we organize key value pairs. So in this example, I have keys, the numbers here, and I have values that are associated with those keys. So it's basically a dictionary or a map. As you know from Python, I want to organize such a mapping, a dictionary, with a B-tree. And here you see four different entries. So the first entry maps 67 to T, the second 72 to K, and so forth. Four different entries. And they're organized on a page. That's very important here. So the B-tree is aligned with your storage layer. So on a storage layer like external media hard disk, there's this minimal amount of data you can read and write, the page concept, yeah, or sector on a good old hard disk. And that's a multiple typically of 512 bytes or larger unit. We talked about 4 kilobytes last time. And basically what the B-tree does is it organizes its nodes and leaves such that the node is exactly the size of such a page. Yeah? The leaf as well. This, what I'm showing here, is a leaf. And one important thing about the B-tree is that exactly matches the storage unit in your storage hierarchy. So if your page size in your storage hierarchy on the slower levels, disks and stuff, is 4 kilobytes, that is the same unit that will be used on the B-tree. If the B-tree lives in higher areas of the storage hierarchy, it can have smaller page sizes. It's like a cache line size, 64 bytes, for instance. You could also organize it along those granularities. That's totally fine. Yeah? That's one trick that's very important in B-trees. Make sure that the nodes are aligned with the units you use to move data up and down in the storage hierarchy. Yeah? So assume you have that data, and now you want to add more data. Like here are a couple of more key value mappings. One thing you could do is, well, you redistribute the entries. What I'm doing here is basically I sort those entries by the key. Yeah? So by this key, before it wasn't sorted, you see it here. It was sorted inside such a page, ascending inside such a page, but not across pages. So if I add another second leaf, a second page, then I could also organize, I could sort across those two pages. And then what I could do is I add another page, a so-called descriptor. So the descriptor will tell me, okay, if there's an entry that's smaller than 75, you have to look on the left side. If it's bigger than 75, you have to go to the right side. So with that already, you see, you can easily answer queries, of course. Yeah? If you're looking for all keys, if you look for key 87, yeah, you start here. You know I have to go to the right, and then you look it up here. The interesting question is, of course, where does data reside that has a key 75? That is something that you can basically fix once and for all for an entire tree by saying, okay, if it's equal to what you find here, you go left always. That could would be one variant, or you say no. If it's equal, you always go to the right. Yeah, but that's something you can set once and for all. It doesn't really matter algorithmically. But basically, if you proceed with that, we keep on adding data and data, we always get numbers in basically in the entire integer range, we could basically always resort the data across all those leaves. That's super inefficient. I know you shouldn't do it like that, as I mentioned, but basically like that, you can create a B-tree, yeah, fitting all data you ever want. So here you see what I changed is now I have two descriptors. And you see here, this tree has a invariant that everything to the right is greater equal. You see, there's an entry with 84. So basically everything, so when you look for 84, here the variant, assumption is then you go to the right and not to something to the left. So basically these entries partition the key range into three disjoint ranges. And we can recurse on that. And basically when you do that, what would also happen that eventually those descriptors, which are also placed on a page, like the leaves, they must be at most as big as a page on your storage unit. They won't have room anymore for new entries. So you will recursively keep on adding more descriptors. And that happens here. So you see there are two layers of descriptors and one layer of those leaf entries. And that would be a B-tree, a valid B-tree. So that's the idea, that you basically have page-sized descriptors and entries on the bottom called the leaves that actually keep the data. Yeah, with that we can look at how node and leaf sizes are defined in that world. So basically I have nodes, I call them descriptors, it's the same thing, but I will be calling them nodes in the following, and we have leaves. Only the leaves contain the data. The nodes contain routing information through the tree. So none of these characters, the values in that world, are contained inside the nodes. Yeah, that's not allowed in this variant. There are other older B-tree variants that do that, but not in this world. So there's a question: on what level is the B-tree applied? Do the keys and the level pointer places on the buffer? Does the tree live in the buffer? Oh, that's many questions, and we've got to get to all of that. don't worry, yeah, we'll get to that with those. Yeah? So first let's look at the nodes and the leaf sizes. So the leaves are, so the condition for both of these nodes and leaves is that they have to be half full. That's an historic invariant. That's how the trees were invented. So if you have space for 2 K star entries, you must have at least K star entries. So basically a leaf must always be half full. That's an old condition which can be questioned, but that's a condition. And you, within a leaf you have at most 2 K star entries. Now the question is, what is K star? Well, that is of course determined by two or by three important factors. One being, what is the page size? What is your type size of the key, and what is the type size of your values that you want to enter inside that leaf? Yes? So those will implicitly determine those values and the number of available entries in a leaf. And the same holds for nodes. Here you have at most 2K entries and keys, but of course, if you have a certain number of keys, you have one more outgoing pointer from such a structure. Yeah? Here you see it in this example on the left. There's one key only, that's also called a pivot element sometimes, and you have two pointers going out, one to the left, everything smaller, strictly smaller, 75 if you wish, and one to the right, everything's greater equal 75. Yeah? Always one pointer more than you have entries here. And there are important exceptions, otherwise this concept doesn't work. That is for the root node. Yeah? So the root node is, of course, if you already maybe have seen it in the data structures course already, the root node is this topmost node, which is also a node, yeah, in this terminology, or descriptor, as I called it before, and it has also page size. And that's called the root node. And this root node has some extra rules, that is, it may have less entries. So here you see it's also fine if it only has one entry, yeah, rather than it is half full. And the same holds for situations where the tree only consists of a single leaf. Yeah, assume you have huge pages, in your tree and you only insert a single key value entry, well, then of course you can't fulfill the invariant that that leaf is half full. You have to add more and more data. So basically, that's a situation where there's only one leaf in the tree, and that leaf is at the same time the root of that tree. Yeah, in this situation, you can enter an arbitrary amount of, still limited by 2k star, of course, but you can also live with only inserting one entry. Yeah? Otherwise, that wouldn't work. So those are the sizes of the different nodes and leaves. And then there are a couple of properties that are maintained in a B-tree. Those are, again, historic properties. And I think you can question all of that, but for the moment, we live with that and we just take it for granted. And that's how it is. And that's how people in the 70s invented it. And that's okay. And there are many reasons for that. And we will go into some of the reasons here and there and question them. So one is the path from the root to any leaf has always the same length. So if you learned about balanced binary trees, ABL trees, there the lengths may differ at most by one, and you have maintenance algorithms that do exactly that. Here we say, no, it's exactly the same length. Whatever path you follow to whatever leaf you go down from a root node, it's always the same length, and you see it here already. The length is always, depends on how you define it. Yeah? You can define it by the number of levels you cross. So if that's the first level, the second, and the third level, you could say it's a step size of three, but you could also define it by the number of arrows you cross, and then it would be one, two, whatever you do. Starting from the root, that's always two arrows you cross, and then you hit a leaf. Okay, so that's the same length property. The other is, I mentioned it already, K and K star are implicitly defined, of course, by the sizes of the pages you're using, the sizes of the types you're putting into the tree, the type size of the keys and the type size of the values. It's not allowed to put values in these inner nodes, yeah, and in these or index nodes or descriptors. Only on the leaf level you are allowed to put data or values. And the data inside nodes and leaves are sorted by key, which allows you to, inside a node and leaf, do an efficient lookup by means of binary search. Yeah? You can quickly do binary search within such a tree. So basically, do we have an example here? So it's basically a two-level structure, you could say. Yeah? Because in order to look something up within this descriptor, for instance, you would use binary search, but just on the keys inside this node. So you can do a binary search here to find the appropriate arrow to chase down to the next child. Yeah? And then once you hit another leaf here, of course, within that leaf, you can do another call to binary search. But it's not that all of the data sits in one huge area and you call binary search once. Yeah, if you put all data in a huge array, yeah, then you call binary search a binary search algorithm once. Look it up and that's it. That's not how this works. So it's traversal from node to node to node to eventually a leaf. And in order to identify the right elements, the right arrows in a node or the right key value entries in a leaf, what you do is inside a node, you do binary search and inside the leaves as well. That's very important to understand. Okay, so what these trees then do is basically they partition the data space into intervals recursively. You see it here for this example, a tree with two levels of nodes and one level of leaves. And what you see here, again, there's this condition that if it's equal, yeah, if the pivot is equal, the right subtree contains all of the data. So basically what this arrow is saying is everything that is equal to 123 or greater sits on the right. So basically this arrow here represents the half open interval from 123 to infinity. 60, on the other hand, this represents minus infinity to 60. And what sits in the middle here is 60 including till 123 excluding, so this half open interval. So basically, each of those nodes partitions the key space. And you see that this happens recursively here. Of course, for the next node, this interval is further partitioned. Yeah? So when you go down here, you already know, you can read this as an invariant. You know, whatever is represented in this part of the tree must be in this interval. Otherwise, you have a bug in your tree, obviously. But you can recursively continue partitioning. Yeah? By here you say, okay, everything that's smaller, 63, excluding sits on the left. And so basically what this leaf represents in terms of data is 60 including until 63 excluding, and so forth. Yeah? So basically recursively partition the key space. And the more levels you have, the more partitioning you have. But obviously the effect you see here is for searching. Now if you search for any key in such a tree, well, you hop down the tree and basically you end up in the end with a small portion of the data rather than all of the data. You don't have to scan all of the data, all of the tuples contained in such a tree or contained in a relation. Typically, the tree helps you to focus on a specific small partition that you have to search for qualifying elements. You don't have to go through each and every tuple. That's a major effect of such a tree. Okay, so here's again an illustration on how this works. So for a find key operation, that would work as follows. So find key means that's a point query where we want to have all the entries where the key equals 67. And that's what we see here. So basically you start at the root. Yeah, you find out, yeah, that must be this arrow I have to follow. Then you follow this arrow and then you can do binary search inside the leaf again. And then you find this entry. What do you do for a range query? Now assume we want to have all entries with keys in range 34 to 72. Well, in this situation, if you start at the root node, you will see, well, you have to follow multiple pointers here because everything on the left here, or not everything, but some data on the left may qualify. Yeah, because, yeah, 34, that's to the left of 60, so I have to go down that path. Not all of the elements qualify, but maybe some of them. And the same holds for stuff in between 60 and 84, so up to 72 only. So I know that those two arrows have to be followed. And then recursively, of course, I traverse the tree. Here it's already the leaf level. And inside such a leaf, then I have to find, okay, what is a cutoff element? Yeah. So what is the data that's actually bigger 34 or bigger equals 34, smaller equals 72? So I have to may have to go down multiple paths in the tree. And that's not very efficient with respect to the storage hierarchy. And that is the reason why B-trees have a second means of allowing you to compute range queries. Yeah? So if you have a standard tree structure as explained so far, you will have to do this as just explained. But a B-tree also offers a second type of access to the different leaves, and that's called the index sequential access method, or for short, ISIM. And what that means is, on the leaf level, in order of the keys, you have an additional mechanism to jump over leaves. So that's illustrated here with those arrows. So basically, that means when you're here in this leaf, you can point to the next sibling leaf. And if you're at this leaf, you can also jump directly to the next sibling leaf. You can do that in both directions typically. For practical purposes, you will mostly only use the arrow from the left to the right, but there are other reasons for doing that. So bottom line is there are extra arrows here on the leaf level which turns this structure into a DAC, a directed acyclic. No, it's actually not acyclic, not even acyclic. If you consider, if you split them apart, you can also do rounds now, right? Okay, but that's the idea. Shall we look at the questions here? When adding new data, do we have to sort all data and change all node values? No, I will get to that in a moment. I will show you how to efficiently create such a tree through a method called bulk loading. That will come up in a moment. Yeah? So just let's look just at the properties, how a B-tree behaves, the structural components it contains, and so forth. So, let's look at ISIM. Let's continue with that. And what you can now do in ISIM is, rather than at the root node, traversing multiple arrows down the tree, what you do is you just look up the first boundary of this interval, which is 34 in this case. So basically, you turn this into a point query, which means you look up 34. Where would I find the entry 34? So okay, it must be left to 60. I go down in this leaf. I do a binary search. You find, oh, that's the entry. And now, in order to look up the other elements, you keep on searching through the leaf level until the value you inspect is strictly greater than your right boundary, which is 72 in this case. Yeah? So you basically go down with a point query to this element, and then you keep on scanning the entries. Recall, they are in order inside each leaf. They are sorted. Across the leaves, they are sorted. And from this entry here, from this leaf, you can directly jump to the next leaf in the right order. And then you see, 67 is contains, 72 is contained, 73. No, that's bigger. That's strictly greater than 72. I'm done. That's how you answer a range query in a B tree. Okay. So with that, we have the main operation. So we have this, we have a point query. So we had it here. Yeah, find key, that's basically looking up an individual value. We have find range, that's also called a range query, looking up a range, a one-dimensional range of values. And now look at some other operations like an insert operation. So assumption is you have an existing tree and you want to insert something into that tree. How does that work? So let's assume we insert 74. So how do we do that? The main idea of this algorithm is again to issue a point query to say, okay, let's see, assume I wanted to look up 74, where would that be? Which leaf is affected? In which leaf do I have to insert that information? That's the interesting thing we want to find out. So we follow the yellow arrows in this example. Yeah? We start with the root node, we see it's in between here, okay, it must be here. So basically we know, okay, in between those two values, 73 and 83, we have to insert the 74. That's basically what we have to do. But there's no room. We can't insert it. This leaf is already full. This situation may happen, but it doesn't have to happen. But in this situation, it's full. If there were still an empty space, everything is fine. Yeah, just make sure you insert it in order in that leaf and everybody's happy. That's fine. But here, that's a different situation. We see, no, there's no room for that. In that situation, you have to perform a so-called split operation, which means you have to split this leaf into two. And that happens here. And basically the difference here is that the important thing is that you still have to maintain all the properties of the B-tree. That is, all paths have the same lengths, the leaves are ordered along their keys. You will find everything by starting from the root. You must be able to find each and every entry following this interval partitioning. And that is what you have to maintain. So if you roll that back again, think about this situation. What we do is we have those entries, 67, 72, 73, 83. Now what we do is we create a new leaf. Let me open my iPad here. Let me scribble a bit. Okay, here we go. right. Yeah, we may make that a little bit. So basically, what we do is we are in this situation here. And I make some room here for the next leaf. Basically, that's where we are. And now I know I have to insert something here, but there's no room for that. So what do? I create a new leaf here. Yeah. And I insert it into this isim order, of course. And of course, what I have to do is I have to maintain the property that all entries are at least half full. That's, I told you, that's an invariant. And if you now just create a new leaf and put somehow one entry there, that wouldn't work. So you have to maintain that invariant. And that's what you see here. Yeah, here on the top right, you see I have 67, 72 that existed before. I leave it there. The 73 and 83 are put to the next, to this new leaf, and this value I'm inserting, 74, is also put to the new leaf. I could also put it here, it would still maintain the invariance of the B tree, it doesn't matter. But here the invariant is basically, there must be at least two entries in the leaf, otherwise it's not a valid B tree leaf. Yeah? And that is something I have to do. And that's basically, so what happens is, if you look at the iPad again, basically the entries that existed here are now redistributed in a way that half of the entries are here and half of the entries are here. And then you can make a decision on where to insert the new element 74. And here the decision was made to insert it there. So I insert it here, but I have to push the 83 a bit to the right. And then I have basically this situation. This is three or four entries in this node are filled here, whereas only two of the four entries are filled here. So invariant maintained. And then the next that you see already here in the slide is, well, this leaf has to be known to the topmost node. Yeah, and that basically means I have to add an entry in this descriptor node here. So when we look at the descriptor here, you see, in contrast to what we had before, there were two entries, which means we have three outgoing arrows, and now we need another arrow. And that also means that there has to be three entries. And that happens here. So we go from 6084 to 607384, and we add this new yellow arrow. So that's basically the final thing that happens here, that I say, okay, I add another arrow. Yeah, I add an appropriate entry in that node here in order to be able to find stuff. So in this case, at 73, I simply picked the leftmost entry of this new leaf. Huh? So that means that everything from 73 including up to 84 excluding will be found in this leaf. That would be one way of doing that, but sometimes there's more room in between those entries and you can pick any arbitrary entry here as long as you will be able to find stuff through the search algorithms. There's one question. So why is this the optimal way of inserting elements into a leaf node? Why is this the optimal way? Well, that's how the algorithm works. If you say optimal, you always have to define optimal with respect to what? That's a big confusion in computer science. Optimality is often assumed to be against some complexity classes. But that doesn't have to be the case. So if you say optimal, you must specify optimal with respect to what? With respect to CPU, with respect to storage, that you have to define what you mean by optimal. Otherwise, the question doesn't make sense. What happens with the split is I don't introduce a path with a different length. So the leaf here has this arrow here, the tree still has this balance property. All paths have the same length. Okay, there's a follow-up, runtime complexity, optimal, yeah, runtime complexity. No, this is not necessarily runtime complexity with respect to what? To the split, to the upcoming point queries, to the upcoming inserts. So it's a much more complex story here we're looking at. We're looking at the B tree that somehow mapped to the storage hierarchy in terms of pages. We have a so-called workload. Yeah? The B tree should support upcoming point queries and range queries. So can I build the B tree in a way that those point and range queries are supported effectively? And that's not easy to answer what optimal means, because optimality here is defined, or in databases, it's defined with respect to the upcoming workload. So to the work I do in order to split this leaf, but also with respect to the upcoming workload. And that makes it a big more complex, because if I only looked at the specific operation, yeah, I could do that. But the more interesting thing is, did I maintain the tree in a way, or did I insert something in the tree in a way that upcoming operations are supported well? And that's the interesting question. Other questions, but I think there are cases when you end up in half full leaves and never have a new number. You end up in half full leaves and never have a new number inserted. There are cases where we have a half full leaf that may happen. And we have it here, that's half full. That may happen, and now you insert something and that's no problem. Until you overflow again, and then you have to split again. with that, I would like to continue. Yeah, here's a before after image. Basically, the comparison of these two slides, what happened in this split operation. The question is, of course, how do you support that algorithmically? So here's how this is basically an object orientation implementation pseudocode of what's going on. Basically, a straightforward way of implementing that is that you have an object, so you have an interface abstract node, and then you have a node implementing that interface and a leaf implementing that interface. And with that, you can write down the insert operation for a particular key and value for a node, and you could write down the insert operation for a particular leaf. That is this one. And maybe we start with a leaf. So what happens here, because it's a bit easier to understand. So assume you want to insert something in a leaf, and that's this key value entry I was talking about. Basically, you check if there's still room. So if this condition is violated, this means we don't have room for that. So if you're in the else branch, everything is easy, everything is fine, there's still room for another entry. And so we insert it locally into that leaf and return this null comma null tuple. That's the convention here I will explain in a moment. The more interesting case is if you split the leaf, as I showed you a moment ago. In that situation, you split the leaf, and the split operation, how it is implemented in this pseudocode, assumes that you return a new leaf and a new leaf pivot, so a key that separates this new leaf from the old leaf. Then you check into which leaf to insert this element you actually want to insert, depending on the split, maybe left to or right, and then you insert it either in this split, in this old leaf that you were splitting, or in the new leaf. So basically the convention here is, that is the leaf you're splitting, and then you create a new instance, and that is this leaf. Yeah, so those are the conventions in the pseudocode. And then you basically return some split information that you can use in the recursion. And now it gets interesting. If you look at the nodes, basically recall we start with a node. So we traverse this tree. So basically, in order to insert something into a tree, you call an insert method on the root node. And that is what is assumed here. So the root node in this example I showed you is an insert, has an insert method. I call it with a key value. And basically the first thing I do is, I explained that multiple times now in examples, is I have to choose a specific subtree. It's a subtree to follow. And that is what this method does. So I pass a key to this method, and the method will return to me the next subtree to follow. In other words, if I call this node with insert, choose subtree with a specific node will point me to the subtree. Yeah? So every new layer in such a tree is again a tree or a B tree. So that happens here. And now I check whether that split occurred or not. That's a convention so basically here, what I do is I call insert on the subtree. I reroute the insert information to the subtree, and I use the return value to understand whether that subtree was split. Yeah, if the subtree was split, something will be returned here. If it was not split, it will return null. And I basically check here against null to understand whether a split occurred. So only if it's not equal null, then I know, okay, there was a split, I have to do something. If there was a split, recall, I have to insert a new key into my existing node at this point in time, and that is where all the magic happens. Yeah? So basically, schematically, what happens here is you walk down the tree, you call insert on this node, this picks choose subtree, it calls insert on this leaf. On this leaf, you perform the split operation. This one I showed you before. This is a split operation, and basically the call you issued to this leaf will return the appropriate information, which you can check for in the node, in the calling node, when returning the function call. So if this is not null, you have to do something here, right? And then you can insert something like the 73 in this node. So that's basically a trick you exploit here in object orientation, that we walk down the path once, and we use the return information to pass to check whether splits occurred, and then recursively solve the problem. Because of course, recursively, these overflows and splits may occur on any level of the tree in this situation. Yeah? So that's basically the idea of implementing a split. And now the interesting question is, assume we insert another element here. Yes, so assume we add another leaf here. We get another entry there, okay? Now we add another entry, which means that this entry has to be split. What happens? Just idea-wise, not so much in the pseudocode, but what would happen? Think about that for a moment. Yeah, you see there's one entry left here, so I could add another leaf here. Those leaves will be added through splits of leaves, so that could happen. For instance, assume we want to insert 90. This leaf would be split. Yeah, we add another leaf here. Then we add another arrow here, but then this node is full. Now what happens if we insert, say, 17? What would happen in this at this point in time? Do you have an idea? Yeah, someone is writing, add a new root. Yeah, but how exactly? Yeah, I scribble it down briefly on my iPad. You can still think about that, what happens. So far we have these, So basically we have these four leaves. And now assume that's the situation. Yeah, you have this ISOM links always, of course, they're all maintained through the splitter as well. And now you insert something in this rightmost node, leaf, sorry. So that will lead to a situation like that. Yeah, another entry here. All those entries are occupied. Now what happens if you insert an element, say, in this leftmost leaf? So someone writes, I guess we can basically do the same thing as a descriptor has enough keys and values to keep up. After we split the descriptor into, yeah. So that points in the right direction. So basically assume we split this leaf on the left. Yeah? So basically we are in this situation and now we don't know what to do with that. Maybe, so basically we would have to put it here. Yeah? So this is the old leaf. If we split it, we have to put something in the middle. Yeah, we adjust these arrows here. That's what happens. And here we have to enter a new arrow. And that's not possible. What happens in this situation is that we split this leaf. So basically, in other words, we would create a new node here, redistribute the arrows to the two nodes, and create a new root node on top, pointing to the two descriptors here. That's basically what happens. Yeah. So now it gets a bit confusing if I scribble all the stuff here, but basically these arrows are reassigned and redistributed over the different arrow nodes, and those will be removed. That's basically the idea. So that is the only way for a B-tree to add another layer to increase the length of the path. That's the only way that can happen in a B-tree. So you see the balancing property is still maintained, and it's maintained by splitting the existing root node into two and adding another root on top. That's how it works. Yes. Okay. Yeah, if you have inserts, you also have deletes, obviously. So basically, those are like the inverse situations. Yeah, assume we are here, we want to delete 74. And then that's relatively easy. Here's another situation where we're in this situation now, and now we delete 73. And then you would violate that invariant, the leaf has to be half full. And in this situation, you do the inverse operation to a split. That is, you merge leaves or nodes. So in this situation, you see, okay, now I'm merging 83. So if I kick out 73, I have one entry here, and I merge these two leaves to become this leaf. And that is doing exactly the inverse operations as of the split, which means one of the leaves will be removed, this one will be removed, and that also implies that the arrow pointing to that leaf from the upper node has to be removed. So here I still have three descriptors. Now I kick out one of the descriptors such that invariants are all maintained, and now I end up with that. It's exactly the inverse operation to a split operation. No? So this may also happen in a tree. So I scribbled it down again here. That's the gist of what I just said. So delete is the inverse of insert, obviously. We first find the key as in the insert operation, then delete the entry from the leaf. We check whether the leaf underflows, and if it underflows, we merge it. And we can do that again recursively. And merge is the inverse of the split operation. So we first merge two nodes into one. On that case, it actually can, again, only start from the leaf level. But start on the leaf level. And then from the leaf level, it may go up the tree. So again, as with a, if you're in this situation, of course here, if you now remove another leaf, if two more leaves get merged eventually, we have the same recursive effect as with splits, then it could mean that such a node underflows. So what would that mean in this situation? If you listen closely, what would that mean? So how do we execute the merge operation in this situation? Assume I remove, let's say, whatever, 102, 105, and then 87. Well, I have to merge, right? What happens in that situation? Maybe think about it for a moment. What kind of merge would happen on the node level in this situation? You're merging leaves, and I told you, okay. Well, then one of the arrows has to be removed, right? And then if a node underflows, it has to be half full. That's an invariant. You have to do the merge. What happens in this situation? In this concrete example here. I guess we want to do the least possible amount of merges, so we would need to split again if you merge into the new data. So one of you is writing, that's more like to what I explained before. Of course, you may do merges and you may do splits the merges back and forth. In particular, it's an oscillating effect at the boundary. You keep on you insert a tuple, you delete it, insert tuple, and then you have splits, merge, split, merge. You don't want to do that. So you can be more lazy on that. And that's one of the reasons why actually many B-tree implementations don't implement a merge. That's completely ignored. Or they're a bit more relaxed and say, okay, now underflow in terms of half of the leaf or node is occupied. I don't stick to that much. I'm a little more gentle on that, and only eventually I will merge them. That's one implementation strategy. Okay, but now there are a few answers after some removes. And maybe can, no, let's copy the 73, delete the pointer to the next leaf, copy the 73. So assume we have to remove one of those leaves. So the obvious thing that would happen in this situation is you remove one of the arrows, the inverse to the split operation. Then you remove one of the entries here. So this node is left with one entry and two arrows. That would happen, okay? But that also means that this node underflows. So how do you merge that node now in this situation? It underflows, it has to be merged. But with which node do you merge it? With which leaf? What happens? Maybe we can also, given the time, it's 1:05, I would say, take it to the break, discuss it. Maybe if you're also listening to the stream, with other people. I highly recommend, again, the temporary channel feature in Discord. Yeah, so I heard that many students do that. They create a temporary channel with three people, and then each of them sits in separate rooms and listens to the YouTube lecture, but you can still talk to each other if you were sitting in the lecture hall. Yeah? So maybe you try to do that. Yeah. So think about that, and I will present the solution afterwards at 1:15. So 10 minutes from now, I will continue with this lecture. See you then. So let's continue. So again, we were in this situation, and I said, okay, what happens if you remove this leaf? Then you have to remove this entry, 84. Then this node underflows. So what happens with the merge operation? Because I said it's underflowing, it must be merged, right, recursively. This may happen on a leaf and on a node level. And well, then you recall, in this, here we are in a special situation. The special situation is that this node is a root. And I told you that, okay, for roots, we have extra rules. If we go back, what was that slide? Here, we said, oh no, this is an underflow is fine. Even if it only has one entry, zero doesn't make any sense. But if it only has one entry, that's fine. We have two children in that situation. So if you had zero entry with one children, wouldn't make any sense, right? Because you don't split up the search space. But that is fine for a root node. Otherwise, the algorithms don't work. If the situation were different, in the sense that, if we go back again, we're here, if there were another node on this level and another root node, then of course, obviously, then you would merge recursively. Yeah? If you underflow, then you merge. That's how this works. Okay, so with that, I think we went through that. Then we can look at other properties of B-trees. There are many, and I'm just showing the most important ones because they occur all over the place. So one is a clustered property. So typically in a database system, how we organize these, maybe we have relational tuples, and it's not just like, as I showed you before, there's an integer mapping to a character. No, it's an integer mapping to a tuple, typically. That's what you use these indexes for. And then what we can worry about is the so-called clustered property. And you see it here, what we have, what I introduced here is a different type of usage of such a B-tree that I'm saying, no, there are three types of nodes, so to say, or three types of pages, if you wish. In this situation, we still have the index nodes, the green nodes, we have these index leaves, the leaf nodes, that's blue nodes, the blue boxes. And then we have these gray boxes, those are the actual data pages. So basically, if you think about what a database system does, it has a couple of data that's distributed over pages, and no one forces you to have an index. So basically, if you don't have an index in your database or on your specific relation, you only have those gray data pages. You have tuples sitting on those data pages. And then in addition to that, you sometimes create an index, or the database system also does it itself automatically here and there. Also a long story. Huh? But basically, you start typically with those gray boxes, that's your data, and then you can make a decision to create such an index because you understand, oh, yeah, that index would help me to answer queries much more efficiently. So basically, this index is an outside thing created on top of the data pages. And how you could do that is in the following. Here you see that the order of those keys in that index, these 11, Tabelle erkannt, whatever that means. Whatever that means. So basically, what can I do this? No. Sorry, this PDF viewer is confusing me. So basically, what we're doing is the order of the keys on that leaf corresponds to the order of the data in the data pages. So basically here you see this 11 points to this, 15 to that, 34 to that, 56. They're all contained even within one page. But if you see the situation here, basically the order across those data pages here, the gray pages, corresponds to the order of the keys on the leaves, on those blue boxes. Then when those two orders correspond, we call it a clustered index. And just before explaining why that makes sense, let's look into the opposite case. That's an unclustered index. And such an index, well, the index looks the same till the blue boxes, green and blue is the same. Yeah, I go back again, say it's the same thing. But then the interesting question is, where do these arrows point to? So here, this arrow points to a tuple on this page, then to that. So all these arrows go crisscross. And that is different in a clustered index. And what is the difference? And why would that make a difference? Well, the difference it makes is in range queries. Assume you have a range query on a clustered index, versus you have a range query on an unclustered index. On a clustered index, basically you can do a point query, again, run down to the data page, and then redirectly over the data pages. They are in order. They have the same order as your keys. So it's sequential I/O. You don't have random I/O. But here in this situation, if everything goes crisscross, now if in order to identify the entries that belong to a specific range you're querying, you know, the find range operation, you may have to follow many pointers and have to fetch data pages from very different places on disk. That's basically the story behind that. So that implies that in a disk-based system, where you answer a range query on an unclustered index, you can go and you can be in all kinds of trouble, because that may trigger a lot of random I/O. If you think about our lecture on hardware, when we looked at this random and sequential I/O trade-off, yeah, if the random I/O is relatively small, then in an index structure like this, you may be in trouble. And also, of course, typically, so that's also the reason typically for you try to avoid unclustered indexes. Or try to avoid that, in particular for range queries. That's something that doesn't work too well. There's two questions about the inserts. No, I'm not going into this for the moment. Let's look at these indexing types. There's another thing how I explore that, how I showed you that, is you can make a difference between a dense and a so-called sparse index. So what is a dense index? And a dense index, you see that you have entries for each and every tuple that exists in that relation. Again, that's the tuples that live here on the gray boxes, that the actual data pages. And you see there's one arrow pointing to each and every tuple, which means you have to have an entry for each and every tuple in such a leaf of that index. But another way of organizing that is you could say, no, I make it a sparse index. And that is what this shows. Basically, what you're doing here is you're exploiting the partitioning property of the index again. And that can be exploited in this case because the key space of the leaf level and the key space of the data pages is aligned. So if you go back here, basically that's double the work. Why do you do that? I mean, if you know already, none of this arrows goes crisscross. And you know, if you're looking for 11 in a specific page with high likelihood, 15 will be contained in the same page or the next page. Yeah. If you know that already, you can create a so-called sparse index. And that's what a sparse index does. It basically only consists of a single leaf. Yeah. So there's no node, so no internal node or node in the sense of a descriptor routing you to a specific leaf. There's only a leaf. That's the entire tree. It's one leaf. Yeah? And then basically with binary search, you can directly identify, okay, what's the appropriate pages? What's the appropriate page? In particular for range query, assume you want to query ranges, whatever, 72 to 85, you can quickly find out that you have to follow this, and no, only this and that. Huh? Only those two arrows have to be followed. Huh? So the advantage of that is obviously that you save one hop over one of the arrows here. So the tree has a smaller depth, the path from the root to a data page is smaller. Here in this example, I had to cross three layers, two hops. I hopped from here to there, from there to there. Here in this example, for a sparse index, it doesn't have to look like that, in the general case, but in the general, what you can expect is that the paths may get shorter with high likelihood. That's no guarantee on that, but you make things much easier with that. So that's the sparse index, dense versus sparse. And then you can continue that if you think about this for a moment. So what did I do here? So here I basically said, well, rather than being able to hop to each data page individually, and that's what I'm doing here. So here basically what you're seeing is for each and every data page, there exists an incoming arrow from the leaf. Yeah, 1, 2, 3, 4 arrows, one arrow for each leaf. I could say, no, I don't have to be that fine granular. I could say, well, if every group of two data pages can be reached by the index, I'm totally fine with that. Yeah. Then you have a coarse granular index. That's what I'm depicting here. Here you basically only have two entries for each group of two adjacent data pages. Huh? So basically now if you look for something like 72, you can't hop to this page directly anymore. You have to first follow this arrow, then you have to search through that page and then search through that page and to find 72. So there's a trade-off. You have to search through more data pages, but of course the tree that helped you identify data in the first place got even smaller. Yeah? So those are the games you can play, basically making the index smaller, in particular in a situation where the key domain is aligned with the order of the data pages on disk. Okay. Yeah, that's the extreme version, of course, doesn't make any sense. Just for, yeah, you say, okay, every group of four data pages needs an arrow, but that's fine. Yeah, then this tree here, this index leaf doesn't help at all, because whatever query comes in, of course, you have to search through each and every data page until you find the correct element. Okay, yeah, with that, I would like to go into some optimizations of B-trees. In particular, with respect to memory, yeah. So, because one thing we haven't looked at so much, and maybe we go back to one of those graphs. Let's look at that one. That's fine, because previously, what is an arrow, and how is an arrow implemented? That's an interesting question here. So, if you assume you implement that in C++ or the language of your choice, whatever. You create an object. Yeah? You say you have two types of objects. You have nodes and leaves. You create that. You do a new call. Basically, you get a pointer or reference to such object. And then basically how you implement those arrows is that you say, okay, you point to nodes or leaves. So you can basically exploit again what I told you here. You could say, okay, a node points to abstract nodes. Yeah, you never know what a node is pointing to. It could be pointing to other nodes. It could be pointing to leaves. You don't know. Depends on the height of the tree. Yeah? So that's how you could implement that. So a node has entries for these keys. Let's say integer type, whatever. But then it points to other nodes or leaves. And you can abstract that away in an implementation by saying, okay, that's an abstract node type, if you wish, okay? What did I do? Did I move this? Oh, whatever. Yeah. Okay, and what was I explaining? Ah, so, genau. Yeah, and then the question is, okay, if everything is in my memory, that is fine. But now what happens, and we will also look at that in the context of the assignment for this week. But now what happens if only parts of this tree sit in my memory and other parts of that tree are on disk? So you don't have a pointer or a reference to an object in my memory. It just sits on disk. Yeah? So you need to have a different mechanism to point to. Basically, how that is organized is typically you say, you have page IDs. So all the pages that exist in your system have a unique ID, and you somehow have a way to look up those IDs and understand, okay, which of those pages are currently available in my memory, which of them are still on disk or SSD or whatever and whatnot. So it's not an easy question. How do you implement that? Typically, there's an extra lookup mechanism that helps you understand that whenever you want to follow one of those arrows, whether there's already an object reference or you first have to load this stuff from disk. Okay, that's one thing. But now if you look at a situation, let's assume, I mean, what happened over the past, let's say, 15 years or so is that for many databases, people found out, well, there's no point in keeping data on disk. You can, whatever data I want to query, I load it into my memory, and there's so much main memory available, it's so cheap. Let's not worry about that. Yeah, of course, for other properties like durability and asset, you still have to write out things. We will get to that. But just for the matter of reading stuff, yeah, for looking up stuff, you can keep everything in main memory often in many situations. And then you don't have to worry about this boundary. You don't have to think about, okay, is a page on disk or not? Is it in my memory? You don't even need a database buffer. I think some of you asked that 1 or 2 weeks ago. You strictly don't need a database buffer. You just make sure that all data sits already in main memory. And then there are some interesting tricks you can play with those speed trees. And I'd like to highlight one of those ideas. There are many in that space, but this is relatively cheap and has a lot of impact. And that works as follows. So assume again, we have a B-tree as shown before. So with, so I call it here two-level B-tree, yeah, depends on how you define it. You could also call it a three-level B-tree, up to you. Yeah, so we have two levels of descriptors, of nodes, and one level of leaves. And as I told you before, levels may either be defined by count, yeah, saying this is the first, this is the second, or the third, or you can also say it's the number of arrows. That's an arbitrary definition that you can use. And now, well, what we could do is we could cluster the leaves on storage. Actually, the same trick also works on external storage medium like hard disk, but let's assume for simplicity and for better understanding, this is in main memory, yeah, to make it more tangible. So basically what I'm doing here is I'm saying, well, in a standard tree, all of these leaves, I mean, I could store them anywhere, right? I could, in the main memory implementation, I could say, okay, that's a struct, right? That's a struct with of type key value. Yeah, inside the struct, you have key value, and the struct has length 4 elements, and I put it somewhere. I allocate a new struct, and that's my leaf. And if I need a new leaf, I allocate another struct, and that may sit somewhere in main memory. I don't care, right? And that is where you need pointers from those nodes. But if you allocate those leaves in a way that you say, well, no, I already put that struct into a group of 4 struct where I know they are adjacent, they are sequentially stored on your storage device. So I know if, for instance, from this leftmost leaf with the 8 in the ISIM, you know, okay, I actually now need a pointer to jump to my sibling leaf, yeah? Then you already know because it's stored directly after this leaf, you can jump here directly without the need to have an extra pointer. Because you know, I mean, it's already adjacent if you understand the type. Done, right? So you can throw away all of that information for sibling leaves, okay? But the other thing you can do in this situation is also simplify what happens in the nodes, because in a standard B-tree, you have all these outgoing arrows, but now we can do something easier, and that works as follows. You could say, well, why not throw away all of those pointers? Why not throw them away? Because actually, once you know you enter this group of leaves, you could compute the offset within that group where to jump to. Yeah? So basically, in order to determine the leaf address, yeah, if you look up a specific element here, and now you would have to follow, let's say, whatever, this arrow, for instance, you can simply compute the start offset of this leaf, yeah, by doing something like that. The only thing you need is the offset, Yeah, so what is the start of the group of leaves plus the slot you want to access? So this would be slot 0, this would be slot 1, this would be slot 2, times the page size. Yeah, again, we have page sizes here, whatever page size is set to, but it's basically page sizes. And then basically with that, it's enough to keep only this one arrow, this one offset. Yeah, well, if you know where the group starts, you can compute the start address of the other leaves easily. Yeah, so you can throw away all of those pointers. That's a game you can play in memory. And now we're here. And now what we can do is in the next step, well, now here we have more space available for additional pivot elements, for additional entries on those nodes. Well, that's great. Then we can increase the fan out. So the fan out is the number of child node pointed to. So the fan out for this root node here is 2. Yeah, here before the fan out for this example was 4. And that was already the maximum fan out in this example, because we have at most 3 key entries, 3 plus 1 is 4, that's the maximum fan out, the maximum number of arrows going out. But now if you don't need the room for these outgoing pointers anymore, what we can do is, well, we can use that for even more entries. And that's what I'm doing here. I say, okay, those 3 will also be used for keys. Then I have 6 entries plus 1 is 7 outgoing arrows that become possible now. So now I can do something like that. I can basically, maybe that was too quick, I can basically say, well, the entries that were distributed here across those 2 different nodes can now be merged into 1, right? Now it's basically have 6 entries here, and this represents a group of 7, a group of 7 leaves, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and so forth and so forth. And with that, you can compact, yeah, condense, yeah. Actually, it's a form of compressing a tree in main memory. And in the end, you look up, you come up with a structure like that. That's how it could look like, because you basically fold these nodes into one another. And in this specific example with the numbers I chose, you end up with something like that. We basically have one root node. That's this one. It has 7 entries in this situation, which means you have 8 leaves being pointed to. And you see there's not even this first pointer. This is gone because I know the layout of this tree in my memory is such that directly after this node, the first leaf starts. So I know already that the next leaf follows after that node. And with that, I can even throw away that pointer. So basically, that's a pointer-free structure you can construct in main memory, and that allows you to do very efficient lookups, to have with high likelihood fewer levels in the tree to cross, and it's much more compact. And think about what that means if you use an index like that. Can you see? Can you imagine what might be the drawback of such an idea? What might be the drawback of using such an idea? So we started off with something like that. That is a standard B-tree we looked at so far. And then I told you, no, you can throw away all pointers. Everything is in main memory. And the index eventually looks like this. And this has advantages for lookups, definitely. But what does it mean for the entire system? Can you imagine a situation? Well, that's not so great. So there are some people writing, but how will you make sure that data is still sequential in memory after allocating new memory? Isn't it up to the system's memory management? No. So someone is asking, sequential, it doesn't have to be physically sequential in main memory, actually. There's virtual memory management, and virtual memory management doesn't guarantee that it's physical in main memory. Virtual memory management just gives you an address space to play with. And for this structure, it's enough that all these nodes and leaves are sequential within the virtual address space. Each of those virtual pages is then page forwarded to another physical page. Yeah, and I hardly have control over that mechanism. That's very hard to control without fiddling with the operating system. their ways. Long story. Yeah? But basically, it's enough to have that sequential in the virtual address space, because then you can throw away pointers, right? What if he had to merge L1 and L2, as one is writing? What if he had to merge L1 and L2? So when would we merge? Yeah, that's what one of you is writing. Assume you delete stuff. Yeah, assume you delete 11 and 15, and an 8, and a 5, and a 17, eventually merge L1 and L2. So what happens? That's one situation you can think about. Another situation is you insert anything into the tree. Assume we insert whatever, 30. Yeah? 30 would have to be inserted here in leaf 4. Well, how do you do a split? That could be awkward, right? Yeah. So bottom line is, anything where you do a structural modification in the tree, in the sense you do a split or a merge, that will be tough, because basically you have to rewrite large portions of the tree. If you just remove a single entry, that's not so critical. Yeah? Or if you remove entries such that the structure of the tree is not modified, everything is fine. But once you, for instance, have to insert a new leaf in between L5 and L6, L5 is being split into, let's say, L5B, yeah, then everything that is on the right in address space, L6, L7, and 8, they have to be copied over a bit to the right and fix all these things, and even the node has to be adjusted here. Here there's no room for the node, you have to do this recursive split thing, everything has to be rewritten, in all kinds of trouble. So bottom line is, this is a read-optimized structure that works super well if you only have very, very few inserts, or if you only have very few operations that do structural modifications to the tree. Yeah, then this works very well. But if you have many structural modifications, then this doesn't work so super well. But there are databases, in particular analytical databases, where you are exactly in that situation. There aren't any insert or update delete operations at all. It's just read only. And then you can play those tricks, which make a huge difference in terms of the space you need for the index, query times, and all kinds of stuff. Yeah, that's what I want to show you. That's a main memory optimized index. So here's again a summary of what we just saw. Basically, we cluster nodes into one continuous chunk, no pointers whatsoever. There's a bigger fan out. Yeah? Fan out again for an individual node or leaf. You have more room for these entries. So bigger fan out for a node means you have more outgoing virtual arrows. The arrows are not implemented in the sense of a point anymore, but you have more outgoing arrows on the logical level. The height of the tree decreases slightly. There's no guarantee, but the likelihood increases that it decreases. The read performance increases definitely, in particular as you probably have fewer levels and the data is denser and behaves much better in the storage hierarchy. But the update performance decreases considerably. Yeah, update performance in the sense you want to insert something that triggers a split, or you delete something which triggers a merge. Then that may be very costly, because you may have to rewrite the entire index, which may still pay off. Yeah? I don't say don't use it, but that's a relatively huge factor then in this situation. So what I'm trying to tell you here is, in databases, it's very hard to say there's one algorithm, there's one data structure that solves all of your problems. It depends always, and it depends in most cases on the workload. So the types of queries you want to issue, the types of data you have, the kind of stuff you want to do, yeah? The types of SQL statements you want to run, and they may issue particular lookups on an index. So it's often impossible to say, do this, do that. The first thing to look at is, okay, what are these people planning to do? What kind of queries are they planning to run? Is it read only? Is it a mixed read-write workload, point queries, range queries? And with that, you can then make things much more efficient once you factor that in. Okay, with that, I'd like to look a little bit on how to efficiently create a B-tree. Of course, you can start with an empty leaf, insert into the leaf, perform the splits, create these extra levels, adding root nodes, as I explained to you in the first half today. But that's not the best you can do. One class of algorithms is called bulk loading. And the main idea is you don't increase the size of the tree tuple by tuple, but you say, hey, here I have a batch of tuples. Just create a tree on that. And that's a typical situation you also have in a database system. Typically, you load your data in a database system, and then only afterwards you say, hey, let's create an index on attribute A, B, C, whatever, right? And then you already have a batch of tuples, so you don't have to create the index by doing tuple-wise inserts. That's inefficient. And one particular algorithm that works super well in practice, super easy to implement, is to say, okay, why not do it as follows? Assume we have the data pages again, and this stuff is not sorted. Yeah, you see it again here with those keys. We have 83, 84, 87, whatever. So it goes crisscross all over the place. And so in order to create an index on that, the first thing you may do is to sort the data. So let's sort it, and we do that across data pages. Now you see that all these keys are sorted, okay? Sorting property is maintained. Well, in that situation, now we can do a bottom-up creation of an index relatively easily. As follows, we say, okay, and I create a dense index in this example. You could also do that for sparse indexes and whatever indexes, yeah? But now it's a dense index. So for each and every tuple on the data pages, we will create an entry on the leaf pages as well. And you see it here. So for those four tuples, I created a leaf with those appropriate entries. And now I do that recursively for each and every data page. Here I put entries, so I fill up the leaf completely. And this is example, you could also leave room for future inserts if you wanted. But here I say, okay, I fill that leaf up with all the data available. And as here I only have three tuples, I pick the fourth tuple from the next data page and so forth. Yeah? And once you insert this leaf, you can on top create an appropriate node. That's what I'm saying here. So basically in the next step, I create an index node that separates those two leaves. That's already a valid B-tree here on all data up to and including 83. Yeah? 84 and everything that follows is not indexed yet. Yeah? So this is an index that will only help you looking up data up to key 83. Then I continue with the algorithm. So I create a leaf for the remaining four tuples. And then again, okay, no one is pointing to this leaf yet. So I have to insert another arrow here. That's what I'm doing here. Basically, that still works here. So I can create another entry here in that existing node. And of course, you can now recursively do the entire mechanism in the sense that if you overflow here, you can add another node here and add another layer here, similar to what you would be doing in a split. Yeah, the difference being in the split, the entries are distributed over two different nodes, and then both of them are half full, and one gets a new entry. The difference here being that you can still fill up those nodes completely, almost till the end of the node. So that's something for the exercise for today. Yeah, here's another example how this could be done. Basically, here you have, what you see is, do I have an extra slide on that? What you see is, basically, it's kind of a movement, a sweep over the tree from bottom left to top right in a way. So basically, you start creating the leaf, yeah? Nothing happens. You create this leaf. Now you create this node. You create this leaf. You make another entry into that node. Then you create this leaf. Nothing happens. You create this leaf. You make another node. Then you create this leaf. You make another entry here. And then, well, you better connect those nodes as well, because otherwise it's not a valid B-tree. Yeah? So basically, it's a bottom-up creation. The bottom-up algorithm creating the appropriate leaves and nodes in such a B-tree. Yeah? Basically, by just traversing the database pages in ascending order, creating appropriate leaves, creating nodes on top. Well, one thing what you should think about this week in your assignment is to think about, okay, but does that always work? Do I have to be careful with that? How do I actually do that? In particular, with respect to the invariant that all the nodes and leaves have to be half full, because there are some situations you have to be aware of in that situation. Okay, let's look at the question. What if the data pages are spread across multiple machines? Can we still do bulk loading? Yeah, you can. There are many ways to do that. You can first partition it to have two runs, and then each run is a run of sorted data, and each is bulk loaded independently, and then you create a descriptor on top. Many, many ways of doing that. You can also redistribute the data. But basically, that works relatively easily. I'm not sure how much we get into distributed query processing. That's another large topic. Databases, distributed database systems, in particular with big web services like whatever, Google, Facebook, and all of those. Yeah, they have huge distributed database systems. And they have these issues. Yes, you have data that's spread across 100 machines. Well, now let's create an index. How does that work? Yeah, but that's a different story. For the moment, I assume we have a simple storage hierarchy, one device on each layer. That's complex enough to start with. So. Okay, so here's my summary for today for B-trees. B-trees are awesome. We just scratched the surface of what you can do with B-trees here in this lecture. And if you find a case that you can't do with a B-tree, just make an appointment. We can do a Zoom call and I will probably be able to explain you the opposite. Yeah. So B-trees are awesome. You can do everything with that. They're everywhere. Basically, even our street signs can be considered some sort of B-tree. Yeah, the sign size is a page size. And it's such a simple and a universal concept. You could say, it's clear. In the end, after the invention, it's always easy to say, yeah, I could have thought about that. Yeah. You have to think about that before that exists. So B-trees are everywhere. B-trees are everywhere, in particular in database systems, but in all kinds of data processing. In particular, also if you look at network, routing table, it's also kind of a B-tree node or leaf. Yeah, and then you hop to the next machine, and there's a next node, another routing table. Basically, how you identify a specific server on the internet is basically that's all a distributed B-tree. Many distributed lookup mechanisms can be mapped to B-trees in the end. So B-trees work well across all layers of the storage hierarchy with minor fixes. Yeah, so in particular, the page size. Yeah? The page size of a tree, as I said, on the lower levels, your page size may be according to the unit you use on your disks. On higher levels can be like cache line size, 64 bytes, whatever. You can have a node and levels, leaf size of 64 bytes. The examples for B-trees that do exactly that and then work well with respect to the caches. They can easily be adapted to handle many different types of data and queries. Yeah? So I only showed you point and range queries, one-dimensional range queries, but those trees can also be adapted easily to multi-dimensional queries, two-dimensional queries. Say a Google Maps service looking up the right satellite images to display in a Google Maps service. It can easily be done with a one-dimensional B-tree. There are many tricks to play. There we can't go in that, unfortunately, and it's still those B-trees are being extended and also reinvented sometimes to a large degree in 2020 even. And we also do extensions and research in that direction, how to improve these things. The core concept is untouched. What I'm showed you, there's pages, units pointing to multiple child nodes or child leaves. And that's recursively, and that happens recursively. All the algorithms, they're untouched. They're always the same. Yeah? You can change and optimize constants here and there. But in the end, the core concept of a B-tree is omnipresent, in not only databases but in computer science. Yeah. With that, there's one more question I can look at. So combining bulk loading with a super compact B-tree would actually create a viable solution, of course. Hang-on solution for large amounts of data, which is an extremely short-lived. Yeah, but basically you allude to this, I mean, whether you update the data. Yeah, so what I showed you here, I mean, oh no, it's, I have to go to this arrow. That's our bulk loading mechanism. So here I said, I completely fill up the leaves. And that means the next insert comes in and I'm in trouble. Yeah, because once I insert something, yeah, assume I created, this tree, for any insert that comes in, I will be in trouble. I have, in the sense, I have to split. I have to perform a split. An easy way to around that, if you know inserts will appear, I have inserts in my workload. Yeah? So it's not only about reading data; it's also about inserting data. Then you can already adjust the bulk loading process to say no. Only three of the four slots are used. It's a compromise. It's a heuristic because you know inserts are coming up. If you know there are many inserts, you say, oh, only two out of the four or whatever k out of the 2k are used in that example. Yeah, that's basically what you could do here. Okay, with that, I will be calling it a day. That's it, what we have about B-trees. Next time, next Wednesday, we'll be talking about bitmaps and some other interesting things. On Friday, we will have our lab at 12 o'clock. So I'm looking forward to seeing you there. I will now be available in the audio channel of Discord. Till then, stay safe and see you then.